Okay, so let us continue forward and cover one more topic. This again is from our simplified model. We are still not extending our model, but there is one other thing that I think our simple model can convey to us very clearly, which is how to connect the symbol rate to the bit rate. These two are two different quantities. Remember, symbols and bits. Bits are input to the modulator and the symbols are coming out of the modulator. What is the relationship between the number of bits per second and number of symbols per second? And so that relationship is considered by looking at a complete diagram, which includes not only the modulation but also the encoder block. And we will assume that these bits per second that are incoming are at the output of the source encoder. So we haven't here in this diagram, we have not considered the operation of source encoding, the data compression. This RB bits per second is assumed to be output of the at the data rate, the bits per second at the output of the source compressor, source encoder. Now what we will consider is that there are some RB bits per second. Let us say RB is certain number, let's say 100 bits per second, which means that it takes 1 second to capture 100 bits. Now, no matter what we do to those bits by, for example, channel encoding or modulation, we do not want to either increase the time that those 100 bits take to get transmitted, nor we want to decrease the time. Because if we increase the time that these bits take for transmission, then at the receiver side, the meaning of the bits as it relates to the time will get destroyed. Same thing if it takes less number of seconds to transmit those 100 bits. To give an analogy, let us assume that we are watching a video, and although video is far more many than just 100 bits per second, let us assume that this video is something very, very simple, and so it just takes 100 bits every second. Now, because of this operation that we are doing, encoding and modulation, suppose if the mapping between those 100 bits and 1 second, which is present over here, if that gets destroyed here, so that 100 bits take, let's say, 1.5 seconds or 2 seconds, then what will happen is the video will seem slow. It is as if somebody is doing a slow motion of the video. On the other hand, if those 100 bits worth of video comes to us in less than a second, let's say it comes to us in only 1/10 of a second, then the video will come very fast to us. It is as if somebody fast forwarded the video. So that is not acceptable. And so whenever we do some operation on this information bits, and because of which we either artificially increase the number of bits or we decrease the number of symbols that those bits are getting mapped to, we still want to make sure that the total time required for this 100 bits remains the same. So with that in the mind, let us see what happens. We know that this channel encoder takes some capital K bits and it converts those bits into a sequence of capital N encoded bits, where N is typically greater than K. How much greater than K? That is determined by this code rate R. If R is very close to 1, then N will be close to capital K. Whereas if the code rate is very small, then N will be much bigger than K. So let us consider that R is 0.5, which means that at the input we have capital K bits, but at the output capital N is 2 times K. That is the definition of code rate R. The encoded bits are twice as many as the information bits. But remember that although we converted, let us say in this example, 100 bits every second that were coming in, after encoding they became 200 bits. We do not want those 200 bits to take any more or any less than a second, which means that the encoded bit rate better be 200 bits per encoded, 200 encoded bits per second. Alternatively, we can say that the rate RB at the input to the encoder has now become RB divided by R, by small r, at the output of the encoder. If R is very small, let us say R is 0.1, then the bit rate here will be 10 times the bit rate at the input. Which makes sense, because now you are increasing the number of bits by a factor of 10. But those bits have to be still accommodated in the same 1 second duration every second. Which means that you will have to transmit 10 times as many bits every second. And so that is why the bit rate at the output of the encoder, the encoded bit rate, is RB divided by a small r, where r is the code rate. Now, unlike the encoder, which increases the number of bits that are getting transmitted, the modulator has the opposite effect. Modulator takes total of small k encoded bits together at a time, as we have seen earlier, and it converts them into one of capital M symbols, which means that the symbol rate is 1 over k times RB divided by R. And the reason is that those k bits together now make up only one symbol. If you had, let us say, k equal to 128, suppose we are considering m is 128 and small k is 7. So we are taking 7 bits together. And those 7 bits, we are converting it to just one symbol that is getting transmitted. Let us say for some reason the bit rate here, the encoded bit rate, at the input to the modulator, let us say it is 49 bits per second. So every second 49 bits come into the modulator. Because we want to again preserve the duration of each bit, we would, and because we are taking now 7 bits together and converting it into a symbol, the symbol rate will be only 7 symbols per second. 49 here, 7 here. The reason is that we are taking 7 bits together and converting it into one symbol. So these 49 bits that are coming in every second, they will get converted into only 7 symbols every second. And so therefore, the symbol rate will become 49 divided by small k. And so finally, our relationship between the symbol rate and the bit rate becomes what is shown over here. Symbol rate is RB divided by R times K. Because of the encoder, which operates at some code rate small r, compared to the information bit rate, the overall transmission rate goes up because R is always less than 1. On the other hand, because of the modulation, the transmission rate, the symbol rate, always comes down because the smallest value of k is 1, which is BPSK. So we can take some example. Let us say R is 1/2. So coding is rate 1/2. And let us say that modulation is QPSK modulation. for which m is 4 and k is 2. Then RB and RS are same. If 100 bits are coming every second at the input to the encoder, 100 symbols will be transmitted every second at the output of the modulator. Let us assume that modulation is still QPSK, so K is still 2. But let us say that we want to increase the capability of the encoder, channel encoder, and we made, because of that, we made R to be 0.25. Remember, as R goes down, the overall transmission rate goes up because we are doing 1 over R. And so now if 100 bits are coming in here, the number of symbols that will be going out every second will be 200 symbols per second. So that type of calculation is what is done in this table. Let us say example of this table, that bit rate is 100 megabits per second, which is not unusual. Many times when you are using some really high bandwidth connection, you may get 100 megabits per second. Let us say that the coding is rate R equal to 0.4. Therefore, the encoded data rate becomes 250 megabits per second. The total number of encoded bits that are getting transmitted is not 100, it is 250 megabits every second. The reason is because the channel coding rate is rate 0.4, and 100 divided by 0.4 is 250. Let us also take in this example that the modulation is m equal to 32 array modulation, for which k is 5. And therefore, the final symbol rate is going to be 1/5 of 250, which is 50. So this is the relationship between the bit rate here and the symbol rate at the output of the modulation. Okay, so we covered a lot of ground, as you can see, but all of this, we did it using the simple model that we started out with for BPSK or OOK. We added some complexities to it. For example, we made it two-dimensional and we added far more many modulation schemes, but still, essentially, our modulation block is still simple. Why is it simple? Well, we call something as simple or simplified really when it does not fully reflect the reality. Compared to the reality, this model is simplified. So what aspects of the real communication modem does this model fail to capture? Well, there are several such aspects, and we'll go over them one by one. Maybe only two or three, actually. So one thing right away is that all throughout our simplified model, if we look at what happens at the output of the modulator transmitter, the diagram will look something like this, where I have considered BPSK modulation with A equal to 5 volts. And I have taken that some 20 BPSK symbols, which is just 20 bits, are getting transmitted. And so this is how the transmission output will look like, the modulated output will look like. Although the x-axis is the index of the symbol, I could have easily drawn this where x-axis is actually time. Time in seconds. And then the interval between these two impulses will be 1 over RS. It will denote the number of seconds per each symbol, how much time we are transmitting every symbol over. Inverse of that time, T, symbol is R symbol. I think we have used the notation RS to denote R symbol in the previous slide. So for the sake of consistency, I will just change here this T sim to RS. T sim to TS and R sim to RS. Okay. So this is what our simple model, simplified model, would generate at the output of the modulator. But this is not reality. We cannot transmit impulses like this. There are many reasons. One is it's very difficult to turn on and turn off the transmitter instantaneously. So even if you wanted to do it, achieving sharp impulses every TS seconds apart is a pretty tough job. No electronic circuit can switch on and switch off instantaneously. But the second reason is even more problematic, which is that if I take Fourier transform of this, the spectral content of such a signal is very, very, very high. Especially when you are operating over a fixed bandwidth, when the bandwidth is a constraint, you simply cannot afford to have this type of impulses, because the spectrum of this signal is very wideband. It will easily grow out of the limited spectrum that you have been given to operate on. And so that is where one additional layer of complexity that we will add to this simplified model is to introduce what is known as pulse shaping. And actually, we have already described pulse shaping at the transmitter in an earlier lecture, where we converted each of these impulses into either a triangular or a rectangular or even a square root raised cosine pulse. And we made use of the convolution operation to do so. And so if we consider a slightly more complex, but at the same time slightly more closer to the reality type of diagram of the transmitter, this is how it will look like. What I'm currently showing to you is the simplified model that we have been talking about up until now. But now we will add the pulse shaping part to it. And that, as we have seen earlier, will require us to first of all do some zero insertion. When we insert zeros in between two samples, between two symbols, we are effectively increasing the sample rate. So zero insertion can be thought of as increasing the sample rate, because now although the samples are zero, most of them actually, if you are inserting p minus 1 zeros in between two consecutive symbols, p minus 1 samples are all zeros. If p is, let us say, 10, then after each symbol we are putting 9 zeros. Then again one symbol, 9 zeros. One symbol, 9 zeros, like that. But if we consider those zeros themselves as sampling instants, the actual values of the samples are zeros, but by inserting zeros we have defined those sampling instants, then you will realize that the interval between the sampling instant has reduced by 1 over p, simply because we have inserted those many zeros here. Alternatively, when the sampling duration reduces from TS to TS divided by P, the sample rate increases from RS to RS times P, which is FS, our sample rate. Now, after we increase the sample rate by zero insertion, we want to do a convolution with the transmit pulse shaping filter, which let us say is a square root raised cosine filter that we have already looked at in an earlier lecture. And then in the traditional system, the communication transmitter, the output of the pulse shaping filter, we can think that it is connected to a digital to analog converter, whose output is an analog signal. So this is a slightly more realistic model of the transmitter. Now, with a transmitter which has become more detailed, we would also like to make a receiver which reflects the corresponding design at the transmitter. So again, we start out with our simple model where some samples are coming in at the rate of RS, symbols per second. RS is the symbol rate. And the output of the demodulation, which is based on this decision regions, is X hat. And X hat is exactly RS times small k, which is RB bits per second. So this is our simple model that we had looked at earlier. But in presence of the pulse shaping, we will need to add the blocks, which are first of all analog to digital converter. Then we will need a similar linear shift invariant system at the receiver, which now acts as a filter, as a low pass filter. And then the output of this filter will be capital P samples per second. But we have seen that this block here requires only one sample per symbol. And so we will just throw out the remaining P minus one, capital P minus one samples, and retain only one sample at the output. So this is the decrease of the sample rate. Now, if I put the additional blocks that we have introduced at the transmitter, which is sample rate increase by zero insertion, the use of pulse shaping filter, and the analog digital to analog converter, this is what we added at the transmitter, and we added A to D converter, the low pass filter, and the sample rate decrease function at the receiver. Each of these functions which fall under the same vertical column, they should ideally be the inverses of each other. And therefore, if I consider this entire combination of these three functions in the green, then the composite function should be inverse of this composite function in the yellow. So that is an ideal design of a model. And actually, our simplified model that we had looked at up until now is in fact, I would say conceptually, it conveys the reality, except that it assumes that the green and the yellow, they together make up inverse functions, and so the net effect is zero, meaning the signal changes that are introduced by the green at the transmitter are perfectly cancelled out by the way the signal over here is changed by the yellow blocks, the sequence of yellow blocks. So that is our simplified model. But in reality, obviously, although the goal is to achieve this ideal inverse function, we can hardly do that perfectly. Although the yellow function, the net of these three yellow blocks, will be pretty close to the inverse of the net of these three green blocks, that inverse will not always be exact mathematical inverse. And there are multiple reasons for that. One is that there will be always some inter-symbol interference. Secondly, there will be some timing mismatches, because of which the receiver would not know which of the capital P samples that come out of the receiver's LSI block, which of those capital P symbols to select. If it ends up making a wrong choice, then again this green and the yellow doesn't become, they don't together collectively become inverse of each other. And then finally, although this block here converts digital signal into an analog signal, and this takes an analog signal and converts it back to the digital signal, the practical designs don't make them exact inverses. There'll be always some small residual error that we will have to deal with. So this is our additionally complex model. Why do we add this additional layers of complexity? Well, as we said, there are some practical requirements. We cannot be transmitting the signal at a very high bandwidth, which is what it would happen if we did the exact implementation of the simplified model. This filter here, this system, the linear shift invariant system at the transmitter, plays a crucial role in controlling the bandwidth of the transmitted signal. Almost equally important, if not entirely equally important role, is performed by this filter at the receiver. And what this filter does is it filters out the out-of-band noise that is present in the received signal. And as we saw earlier, by taking the audio examples of a bird chirping with and without noise, sometimes if you don't remove the out-of-band noise, that noise is so powerful that nothing can work in a meaningful manner if you don't do that out-of-band noise filtering. So this filter plays a very important role. And then finally, the operation of sample rate decrease and how best to do it. We can appreciate that by studying the inter-symbol interference effect in a slightly more detailed manner. And that we can do it only after we consider this complete diagram up to the digital to analog converter or analog to digital converter. Okay, so we will take up these items 1, 2, and 3 one by one starting next video.